Hey everybody, once again, I'm Mark Walters with Dallas Comic Con FanDays. Thank you very much for coming out for our final Q&A of the day. And it's going to be the best one of all because I'm hosting it. Woo! So thank you for being here. You guys, I hope you've had a really good time. I think a lot of people have had fun, and it's only going to get better for the next 45 minutes or so. It is a great honor to introduce this man. I met Jason right before he did Conan, and we had a really cool conversation about like the Frazetta influences on Conan and everything. He is truly like one of us. He's a fan at heart, and I love that about him. I'm not going to waste any more time. Ladies and gentlemen, Jason Momoa! We wanted to save the best for last one.
Yeah, okay, alright.
Yeah. Let's go back a little bit and talk about when you first got into acting. Now, for those of you that don't know, your first acting gig, and I don't want to embarrass you too much.
We don't want to say the word, so we won't say the B word.
So everybody know what the first acting gig for Jason was?
Baywatch.
That's right.
This is how you're going to start it.
No, listen. My point is this. If you can survive that, you can get through anything.
Right? Oh, yeah, no, for sure. Yeah, I made an oath. Not too many people make it off that show, but you know, I'm a Midwest boy. I was raised in Iowa, single mother. Both my parents were painters. You know, I grew up using my hands. I know how to work. Actually educated, and I didn't have to depend on any of this kind of stuff. You know, in Iowa they don't give two shits. That's the way I like it. And it's weird because people are like, oh, you're this and that. I'm like, I don't know. It's just isn't me. So anyways, when I got into the business and Baywatch kind of kicked me out, I was folding t-shirts in a surf shop. And my whole family's from, my dad's son's from Oahu. I was folding t-shirts for 60, you know, 60 bucks an hour, or $60 a day, and you give me an extra walking around in the sunshine and be with the chicks for $100 a day. I don't take no mathematician.
Now, did you
have I didn't raise no dummy. I said, I'm going to go down and meet some ladies.
At that point, had you had aspirations of wanting to act, or was it one of those things that kind of fell into your lap?
Yeah,
unexpectedly.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
I was a marine biologist.
Yeah.
I went to school for marine biology. I left Iowa, was down in the Keys. And then I switched to wildlife biology, and I was in Colorado. And then I decided to up and leave that, and my family, really big surfers. I have a really famous family of water, and I went over there to tow into big waves.
Yeah.
19 years old. I was out there and practicing towing into waves.
Do you miss that life? Do you miss kind of just doing it?
I mean, surfing to me is for like really rich people or really poor people. And I'm hustling. I got kids to feed and a lot of art and goals I'd like to do. So, I mean, eventually, when I'm older, I'll be old and gray.
Now, I'm guessing that your immersion in this world kind of came with Stargate Atlantis, like when you started working on Stargate Atlantis. Was that kind of what got you into like sort of the fan, the pop culture community, and what was that first
experience? I'll tell you what, the first time I experienced, we were at Comic-Con. Oh, Jesus, man. This is the first time where I tell you what, these things have really, truly helped me come out and be, and talk, and handle myself. It's just know that it's okay, but normally I'm like, oh man, don't look at me. And I walked on this panel and no one had seen me yet, so they didn't know anything about me. And the guy that was, most moderators are idiots, you know what I mean? So he's... So, this guy was brutal, and anyways, it was a a sea of people.
Yeah.
And the lights, you can't see anything. I mean, just imagine this times 10. And I just climbed up. I drank like pitchers of water. I was just, it was hell for me. But I really fell in love with the people, because like the whole sci-fi fantasy and doing these, because when we do TV, we shoot it, or a movie, and then it's, you know, 2 years down the road, it comes out, and then people appreciate it, and like, you're already onto something else, and it's nice to talk about things you've done. It's great to relate. It's a nice little time for us, and to celebrate the thing that I love. And I love James Bond, I love Stargate, you know what I mean? So, it's nice. It's a dedicated time to the fans. Without you, I wouldn't have a job, so. Thank you for watching Stargate, and I love it, because it's just the action, and then the adventure, and I get to play like a samurai, dreadlock, tattooed, fucking cowboy with a gun. Sign me up, man.
Well, and it's funny, because I mentioned this right before we started, but the first time I met you, we had a wonderful conversation about, you were working on Conan, and you really couldn't talk too much about it, but my concern was how much Frazetta influence was there in it. And when you responded to me, you were very passionate about kind of the whole Frazetta influence and how that was really something that you took seriously. And it let me know that you weren't just doing this as a gig. You were doing this because you really knew the character and you really knew what was behind the character. And I really appreciated that.
Yeah, man, I grew up a comic book fan. So my parents were artists and I'm inspired by images. And, you know, I definitely remember when I saw that Conan picture of him standing on the skulls. I told the fan that I was like, that's gonna be my tombstone. That was the coolest photo of just staying on those skulls. And I got a plane. Fortunately, a lot of the assholes leave the ship. Where it was a bummer that it didn't go better than we hoped for. But the truth of it is, I really strive to make the Robert E. Howard fans as much as possible. Presenter fans. So
it's appreciated, man. It really is.
Yeah, yeah.
So, yeah. And then let's talk a little bit about when Game of Thrones first came about, and when was the...
Oh, that old chestnut.
Oh, did we have some Game of Thrones?
That old chestnut.
When you first got that phone call, first of all, were you familiar with George's
work? Like this. I've never been so excited. I think when my wife said she'll go on a date with me, that was one. I'm pregnant. Pregnant again, and then you're gonna be Khal Drogo. Because I did the audition and I waited, I'm not kidding, like 6 months. They wanted to hire anyone from, not from the States.
Yeah.
I mean, there's only me and Peter Dinklage, but they want Americans. Okay. Yeah. And they wanted to hire everyone from over there, and when I read it, I was like, there's no one in the world that's gonna take this role from me. There's no one. And I'm not, I mean, I play around and be confident, you know, cocky and bullshit like that, but I mean, just to play around. But truth of it is, like, when I did that, I was like, I'm gonna do everything in my power to get this. I called down my ancestors to do that.
I imagine as an actor, that's a really fun one to sink your teeth into, because it's there's so many layers there.
Yeah. Yeah. You released a couple of demons, you know?
I think you did.
Come on. You're about to get the dishes. I'm like, no. I don't want to do the dishes. Everything else you do, just like this.
Sorry, Sam.
It's hard to play king. Most people are like, I didn't say anything. I'm like, I don't walk around like that. Yeah. You don't have that regal, kingly stature. I mean, Aquaman was there, man. But definitely gotta find that air of elegance.
Now, I know that you probably can't say too much, but can you give us something in terms of what we will see from your Aquaman? Because here's how I look at Aquaman. Aquaman is one of those characters that a lot of people give him a hard time. But in the recent, like, New 52 incarnation of Aquaman, we've seen that he can be a real badass. And I'm assuming you're gonna be a real badass as Aquaman.
I mean, I don't know too much about it, because I haven't read just the Aquaman. We've talked about lots of things. So there's not really like a lot of spoilers on people, but the research I've done on 52, and I've met with Jeff Johns, and just the research he's amazing. He's got a lot of powers. He's extremely tough and extremely strong. But I'm excited about Zach's head. There's a big, beautiful map laid out, and I wish I could share, but it'll come out soon enough. We'll see. Just my biggest movie. Just stick around. There's a lot to show for a long period.
Well, I'll just say this, you look like a badass. And all the pictures, everything I've seen, you look
this old thing? Thanks, guy.
All right, listen, I know you guys have questions, and I want to make this about you, so let's take some questions from the audience. Just,
finally.
Obviously, we can't get into too much spoiler stuff, like, with Aquaman.
Yeah, I mean, Aquaman, it is what it is, because next thing, it's on the internet. Trish Momoa reveals, it's gonna be amazing.
Exactly. So we'll start right here, we'll take some questions, and let's try to go as quickly as we can. We'll go with you.
Aquaman, we meet at last. I'm a huge Aquaman fan, and I think I speak for everyone that's an Aquaman fan. I hope it's awesome. And my question for you is, in the research you did you research different Aquaman versions? And if so, which one is your favorite?
I'm sorry to bum you out, man. The biggest thing I can say is, it's like Conan. It's like Conan. There's a lot of different fans. You know, you guys are the fans that got picked on the most. You know what I mean? But they're still the most dedicated, you know what I mean? I just say keep an open mind. There's time for some new things. But it'll all be there. And I think you'll really love it, so. But keep an open mind, and you know what I mean?
Cool. I kind of like not knowing what we're going to get.
You when you see it and just go, like, there's going to be many. We're gonna see a whole. A lot. We're recreating everything.
To change how we think.
A lot, yeah, there's a lot of stuff.
Let's go over here.
How's it going,
there? Don't be shy.
If Marvel had to push you first to play a superhero for their franchise, who would it be?
Marvel pushed me to play. Was that?
Marvel had approached you first to play a superhero for their franchise. Who would it be?
Well, I just say I really love I love Wolverine. Wolverine, I love him. And then
he's amazing. So I mean,
yeah.
Well, I'm in DC, mama.
All right, let's go right over.
Aquaman movie ever?
Oh yeah, buddy. in 2018. Yeah. Yeah, you still like Aquaman.
Right over here.
Yes, I was, as you know, Ben Affleck, when he was announced as Batman, there was so much crazy hatred going on, and I wanted to know when they approached you about it and they were going to announce it, were you any kind of nervous about, you know, anyone, all the backlash about it, or did you just know that you were going to bring Jason to the Aquaman?
Yeah, I think that's long higher. You know what I mean? There's a vision that they want, and it could probably be that tool in the toolbox to facilitate what they wanted. You know, Zach has a beautiful vision of it all. I tried to stay away from all that trash talk until I see something. You know what I mean? And even when it gets to that, I'm just not a big fan of it. But it's just hard to be an artist. It's hard to work in this business. It's hard to do any art form and get it out to the public so that you can slander it or love it. You know? So it's the same thing with like Heath Ledger. It's probably the greatest performance I've seen in the last 30 years.
Yeah. And everybody trash talked him before.
He's going to go against Jack Nicholson. That's the greatest performance I've ever seen. And I don't discredit anyone like Conan. Even with Jared Leto, I think there's different versions of everything. I'm not going to go, it's just different. There's a lot of reboots and things like that, but it's, I mean, some of them I don't understand, some of them I'm like, yeah, it's time for a reboot.
Yeah, so I think we're back here, right?
Throwing some guy on get all tatted up.
Woohoo! Jason, I think I speak for everyone in this room. We appreciate you having me here in the Big D. Just wanted to ask about your former Game of Thrones co-star, Emilia Clarke, Esquire's new sexiest woman alive. I want to ask if you had any fun memories from the set to share with us today.
Good gig.
They're all up here, buddy. Yeah, smile. All for me. But we can take them away.
Let's go right over here.
I don't kiss and tell.
Hi, wanted to say thanks for coming to Dallas, and I'm a huge fan of the Stargate franchise. My question is, I wanted to know, what was it like, or did you do any training when you were playing Ronin on Atlantis?
I think that's where most of my training came from. Bam Bam was a stunt coordinator and fight designed pretty much everything. And we loved building all these different types of fights, so he was, the first person. And then David Leitch and Chad Stahelski. Chad Stahelski's kind of my sensei. He's a guy that really built Conan. And I had a lot of fun. That was high school for me. College, 4 years of learning the craft. 8 to 9 months of working, taught about new equipment, direct, and all things that, I'm a huge Stargate fan, and I'm still very close to everyone, too.
Very cool. Right over here.
Hi. I was just wondering if you could demonstrate a haka for us?
Yeah, go ahead and whip that up, Jared. Unfortunately, I can't love. It's a very sacred. I actually debated doing it as an audition because I thought it would be inappropriate, but I asked my family and they said it was okay. So, last time I did it was when my grandfather passed, so probably won't do it here. Even though it's a big D. Basically, if I do it, it's like everyone's gonna die. Not a good look.
Alright, let's go right over here.
Hi, I'm also a big fan of your Stargate work. And I was curious, out of Stargate Atlantis and Game of Thrones, which one did you have the most fun with?
I had the most fun on Stargate, hands down. That's the greatest one. I mean, constantly. Aside from David Hewlett, I mean, it would be perfect. Listening to those monologues, you're just like, oh. I had to act it. You're like, you don't say anything. I'm like, I have to listen to that. Take after take. That's brutal. That's acting. It's genuinely very interesting. Or it's interesting. I'm sure. But Game of Thrones was probably hands down the hardest thing I've ever had to do. You know, that's the biggest character I've ever played. I barely speak English. So, pulling off Dothraki was. I'm kind of amazing.
right over here. Thank you, bro. I didn't want to have to be the fight.
Hi there, welcome to Dallas. I was just curious, speaking of Game of Thrones, do you miss being on Game of Thrones? And do you watch it? And how proud of you of Khaleesi for how far she's come?
I'm not so proud of her. She's been cheating on me. And I think her choices suck, really. But I feel like she's making some bad decisions. Like, she should just be happy with her three fucking dragons. And just, that's enough. Is that enough? You have three dragons, baby. You a man, you a man that's not even half of me? Seriously. I am one of the biggest fans. I am extremely close to David and Dan, and I'm very proud of them. All the cast, and you know, when they won and just swept the Emmys, it was just like a long time coming. And I'm extremely, shook up about it. And I'm very, very honored to be one of the Americans and part of that. And just an amazing show. And yeah, me and my wife is even, she's a Psycho fan. I just told her a secret on accident, and she literally kicked me out of the house. I was like, I don't know. And I was like, I thought you. And she's like, get out, get out, get out. Nothing for you. Like, oh. I had a great story about that, though, about my wife. You guys want to hear a story?
Yeah.
Oh, brother. Sorry. I'm just going to go ahead and put this right here. So, I'm shooting Game of Thrones, and my wife and my family are there. She's an actress. We don't go to sets. It's like, sets suck. It's fun for people who aren't part of that, but we've been in long enough. It's like, I'm not going to set. So my kids would show up, and like, even when I'm hurting that guy's throat out, my daughter's like, knitting. Like, okay, baby. And she's like, oh, Papa, you're so silly. We ain't back. I'm like, oh, baby. And so she's used to it. My kids are used to it. So we shoot the whole series. My wife never read the scripts, never read the book, but close to every cast member. Like, we all went out to dinner. She knew David and Dan very well. And the show comes out, and come to the premiere, and it's William Morris, and we're gonna show the first two episodes. I'm like, yeah, I'm good. And my wife said, no, let's go. I'm like, just because the first two episodes, I'm not very nice. Where do I want to be around? Bunch of strangers sit next to my wife while I do what I'm gonna do. So I said no. And she's like, you're not gonna stop me from watching. I'm like, all right. So series comes out, we don't have TV, so it's fine. Then the series came out, and then it came out on DVD, and then they sent it to her home. We have a computer. She's like, I'm gonna watch Game of Thrones, and I'm like, alright, I'm going to bed. So I go to bed, and I wake up like 6 in the morning, you know, I get to get to school until then, and my wife's like over me like this, so totally adoring eyes staring at me, and I'm just like, oh, hey, baby, good morning, and she's like, I love you, and I'm like, I love you too. She's like, you're amazing, and this is the first time my wife ever really complimented my work, and she is like addicted to the show, but she never knew what I was doing, and she was hooked. It was a really cool moment to, you know, I mean, to impress someone you love and they know you very well. Yeah, it was funny. I had to die obviously in Game of Thrones like 3 times, right? 3 different types of dying. Like, I never died at that point. Now I die in everything, but like, I got that shit down. You want me to die? I'm like, fuck. I got that down.
Hey, Red Cloud.
So, what was I just saying?
We were talking about the wonderful moment with you and your wife.
Yeah, there's another one. There's another funny moment.
Damn it.
Oh, yes, okay, so, I go, we're laying in bed, I'm like, man, I didn't do this scene where I had to die.
just help me out here. What's this face look like? I mean, just tell me. I mean, this is what I'm thinking. So I do it. She's like, don't do that. Don't do that. You look ridiculous. I'm like, fuck you. She's like, you don't look good. And I'm like, whatever. I'll do it. I know what to do with it. So I do it. It's amazing. Everyone's like, you, the album dealer's like, yeah, you die the best. I'm like, yeah, see, I told you, honey, you don't know shit. I know how to die. She's like, your eyes all doing that. I'm like, that's what's rad about it. I'm like staring at the sun. My friend is like burning out. Like, it's amazing. Let's go right over here.
Hola, my question is, as we can all see, you have a ton of fans, so what's the craziest moment you had with a fan when I met you or saw you?
The craziest moment I've had with a fan?
They haven't yet.
It's not over yet. No kidding. My fans are pretty rad. You guys are awesome. No one ever really crosses their boundary. And most of my real fans know when it's not a good moment to approach me. People that are like, yeah, it's a video. Come up to me last night, and our Uber took us to the wrong Omni. Supposedly it's like 8 Omnis in Dallas, which is rad. We get in here from Fort Worth, we go to 2 wrong Omnis, and I'm like, damn it, it's 12:30 at night. I gotta be, you know, up and throw the bag back in, and this guy's like, dude, you're Khal Drogo. He's all drunk, and I'm like, yeah. Throw the bags in, he's like, dude, can I get a picture with you? I'm like, I don't know, right? And I'm like, literally have bags and everything. You know, he's like, oh, don't worry about it. He's like, just snap it. The face that I'm giving him is just like, I'm gonna fucking kill you, bro. He's like, nah, don't worry about it. I'll take it anyways. Just that's so I'm like.
Did he seriously call you Khal Drogo?
He's drunk as shit. You know me. I mean, he's like, this A-plus, world-class, dumbass. Anywho, he definitely is winning right now.
I'll tell you what, if that's your worst fan experience, you're doing pretty good.
No. I mean, the thing is like, no one's really, everyone's really cool. My biggest thing is get used to paparazzi. That's a hard. That's really hard. Cause when I'm with my kids, I'm like Papa Bear. Yeah, I'm a goddamn silverback. You mess with me when I'm with my kids. Cause here's the thing, my kids don't know about it. I'm like, yeah, man, I mean, blah blah blah. They're 6 and 8. I mean, I don't need them to go to school going, my dad's Aquaman. You know what I mean? Like, I don't want that at all.
Yeah.
They don't know any of that. They just know it, you know? So, I'd rather keep them young and not around that kind of stuff. So, when people come up and they make a big deal about me, if I'm with my kids, I'm always like, I was on your legs. I'm like, I'm with my kid, man. I don't want them. Because they look at me and go, Papa, why do you want to just like, I don't know, they're silly.
They think I'm silly. Aren't I funny?
So we try to mix them up because it's just such a weird thing, but it's awesome too because all the things that I love, like I met Tom Waits with my daughter, and we were in the elevator, and I'm just like, my daughter's like, and he's like, hey, how's it going? And I'm like, Tom Waits, hey, how's it going? And he's just doing the whole thing, and he's like, just keep going. I'm like, I mean, I freaked out. I mean, I get it. People come up and like, I'm like, oh, if you knew me, you wouldn't be. Not that cool.
Oh, man, you're one of us. That's what makes you cool.
Totally, yeah. And so it's always like, but I understand it because I do the same thing.
Yeah.
No worries. We're humans. Right over here. Yeah, it's a project called, right now it's called Ending in the Valley, but it's a true story about this man and wife and child who, leprosy came to the whole island. Basically what we did is they took the lepers to another island and they made a colony. Well, at a certain point, families weren't allowed to go to those colonies with their loved ones, so, say, this big guy was my wife.
Mm-hmm. Good happen.
We had a child, and I had leprosy, my child had leprosy, we got to go, but she couldn't come, but that doesn't make any sense. And so they would separate families, so they called it the disease that separated families. It's about a man trying to keep his family together. But what happened is he ended up shooting the sheriff.
Because, and you know, at this time, you know, Sanford Dole was taking over a government. They were, our queen was in prison. So there was this huge, there was a lot of things happening in Hawaii at the time. And this one man kind of stood against everything. And they basically sent in this huge boat to bomb the side of the island. He hit out this jungle on the north shore of Kauai. The Waialae Island, they bombed it. They Pulitzers, and they sent in a bunch of troops. And the troops would die trying to get to these cliffs where he was at. He just wanted to die with his wife and his kid. He became a hero because the reporters would go out there, and he became a hero from Hawaii. And eventually, they stopped. Wife ended up burying her husband, buried her son, and she came out 4 years later. They tried to arrest her, and she wrote the whole thing in Hawaiian. She wrote the whole, in 1903, she wrote the whole story in Hawaiian. It's a beautiful book. And it got translated like in the 60s. It's an amazing tale of her journey with her husband. And so, Jack London did a story on it. There's many different perspectives of it. You know, a lot of people try to make it like Hollywood-y. The truth of it is, it's a very deep. I'd like to be the Hawaiian who tells the story instead of turning it into a numerous people die and one man fights. I mean, there's kung fu and shit, you know what I mean? Like, they just take these things and get too far-fetched because we need it sometimes. And it's like, no, this is a pretty story that's an American story. And it's never been told, so.
It's beautiful.
Yeah.
Absolutely true. So we're out of here. We'll take just a few more from each side.
Hi, I was wondering who would win in a fight, Guardians of the Galaxy's Yondu or Aquaman?
Yondu, Shmondu. In real life, Rooker would win. But DC Marvel World, Aquaman wins. But Rooker is a badass, and I love him. He's like my crazy uncle.
Thank you for coming to Dallas. My quick question is, once your kids start dating, do you plan to do the dad shotgun? Or the trident, or just being full beard? Because I'm about to kill you.
Do the what?
The dad shotgun, you know, my daughter's going on a date, your dad's in the front porch.
Oh, the dad shotgun? Yeah. Right in the front? Oh, cleaning shotgun.
Did you also?
No, I just throw tomahawks. I don't play with guns. I actually had this idea where I was gonna get stripped down to like just put literally on like no clothes and have like a gag and then put me in a cage. And I just went, but a couple of the uncles are like, yeah, he's real crazy, he's real obsessed with his daughter, but he doesn't want you going out with her, but we have her back by 10. Kid, you know? It's weird, he likes little kids, man. Especially little boys. And Paul. It's Paul, right? Yeah. Really loves Paul. So, meeting everybody, sir, it's 9:30. He's like, yeah, you get about 30 minutes, so. Might as well just stick around. I was like, that was kind of where I was going. The shotgun shit's, man, whatever.
Right over here. Did you also say cleaning your trident? I think that's what you said. Oh, okay. There you go, right here.
Hi. My little sister got me started a little bit on Stargate Atlantis. And I do like some of the action scenes, but I do have a question. Do you do your own stunts? And if you do, what's your most serious injury?
It's funny, the biggest injuries happen. Like, you know, getting out of a booth at, you know, at Chili's. That's when shit hits. I've done a lot of stunts and like I made it out just perfectly fine, and then literally I just twisted, I like grabbed the car seat, so like, oh, that's the way life is. So, Conan probably beat me up the most because there's nowhere to hide pads, so I did a lot of my stunts. But I definitely had some guys. When it's a train wreck, obviously it's just like something I can't do, and I get way too hurt and couldn't finish the production. But then, yes, I definitely have really strong, amazing stuff in the corner and finish the job. But generally, I love it because as a character, I like to, all the movements that I do, like even Conan or Ronan, that is, even though he doesn't say a lot, I don't normally know how to do those things. You know, I train myself to do those things. That's a part of my character. You guys just assume that that's
like I am. I never loved, I didn't have to do that, so I learned and trained to do that, so that's part of my character. So I think it's important to sort of find a stunt guy that really knows how to move like you. And really find the perfect connection. I haven't found like my stunt guy yet, but I have used many about the fall offs. I mean, you know, it's a huge fall. Those guys are amazing. But, and also, I fucking hate horses. I love them, they just don't like me. I don't blame them, but like, get off of me, you fat ass. 240 pounds on your back to see how much you like me. You're gonna be like, get off. I'm supposed to ride it. Go. And you're like,
You're killing the mystery, my man.
I totally am. I'm like, I'm a horse lord. I'm doing all those things, but I'm literally pooping my pants. On I get Conan, you see me ride, I'm like, fuck this. I'm like, I'm pooping. I'm in poop.
Right over here.
I also wanted to ask you about your wife, and on your project, will you be casting her in it, or is she already in it, or do you guys ever work together on film or no?
Yeah, well, I directed her in, I don't actually direct her, I just like point the camera at her, she's amazing. So we pointed the camera at her, and wrote the Paloma, and then I worked with her on Red Road, so I think we're done. Yeah, we're done. I'm done working with her. She's too much.
And was this our last one right here? Okay, last question.
I thought we were supposed to go to five.
No, I have a question, I really do. Oh, he's not even listening.
I'm sorry, this asshole is interrupting me. Hold on.
That deserves a hug.
Hold on one second, it's 4:30. It's 4:30.
Yeah, we can take food. I think
that was just
all
on you. Alright.
All on his
mind. Yeah, if no one else wants to ask a question, I'm out of here for sure. But if you have more, feel free to come up. Sorry, what were you saying?
Have you ever tried out for a role and then been cast up? Something that you really, really, really wanted to do?
No, I'm not really at that level yet. Like, no one's knocking at my door and be like, hey, Jay, we need you to be the next Bond. Sorry, I gotta curl my hair. I got a bunch of shit to do. No, thank you. No, I'm not at that level. I mean, it'd be nice to be at Damon and Affleck can be able to do those kind of things, but it's just not on the cards right now. So I do a lot of things, kind of go, yes.
Yes.
And it's hard as an actor, be a working actor is extremely hard. So right now I have to make a lot of smart choices for your career, which is weird to me because I just want to work. But I don't know how to do that before. So we've been saying those sort of things. That's a bit challenging.
All right, right over here.
Howdy, how long did they have to train you on the horses before you were able to start filming on here?
I mean, I train on all of them, but everyone thinks they're like the greatest horse trainers. You know, I mean, I was in Morocco with Game of Thrones, or I was in Ireland, and you know, in English, you know, Moroccan way, I'm in Bulgaria, they do everything back-ass words. You're in America, you're like, you know, it's Western. So, I mean, everyone's got their own theory. I can ride horses like a mofo, but I'm like, every place I go, they got a different theory, and it's just, I haven't had a chance to really connect with one animal. And generally, sets don't respect, they're usually late, behind schedule, and this is an animal. And, you know, they're hungry, they're tired, they've been on set waiting. I mean, I get grumpy, imagine what a horse does. And then you got a guy getting on the back, and people walking around with all these things that spook him. It's not a really good place for them. Some, they're each designing these different things, so the ones that are all hopped up and like they even crash, you're like, oh, easy boy. The ones that don't want to run because they're just there for, to hit their mark and just chill. And then there's the ones that like hit their mark, they want to prance around, like, easy. I'm the actor, easy buddy. Settle down, show class, easy. So.
Alright, right over here.
How's it going? I had a question about Stargate Atlantis. I was just going to ask, what was your favorite experience about working on that set, and do you still keep in touch with anyone?
Yeah, I do. I stay in touch with everyone. Probably Rachel and Jill the most, and I love Polly, but he's just up in Canada, so I haven't seen him in a while. Favorite experience on it, is that what you're saying? I mean, probably the greatest episode that I had the most fun was the ones about me, obviously. Santita was by the funnest and then by Chris Judge. I really liked beating up on Chris Judge.
Nice. Right over here.
Yes, hi. Welcome to Dallas, and just wanted to ask you a question about what was it like directing a movie, and do you have any future projects, or are you wanting to direct anything else?
Yeah, no, the project I was telling you about earlier, I would direct. I'm producing another film coming out, hopefully it'll be this winter. Co-wrote it, and I'll star in it. It's called Braven, but it hopefully can happen in time, because very small window of a TV show. So I'm trying to do the movie, and I've been directing commercials. So just doing mostly commercials between movies. But yes, I will be on camera a lot. I really, really love it because to me it's an ultimate art form. You know, it's painting, it's music, it's acting, it's theater. It has everything in there. They can reach out to your source audience very quickly. You can change your perspective. You know, show someone something beautiful. I grew up in Iowa, it helps you escape. So I really love it, and also I love seeing beauty in the people that I trust and building them to a level that I believe in them and then makes the product strong in yourself. So I love commanding, I'm sure. but yeah, I really do enjoy it. Cool. You don't sleep though, it's horrible. It's extremely challenging, but.
Right over here.
Hi, I actually had a plan or a question about your brewery plans in Detroit. I'm a Detroit native, and it's not really often that we get positive press. And I was wondering what made you decide that Detroit was the right spot for that.
Well, the greatest water in the world. I mean, that's where our water is. You got Great Lakes right there. Colorado's one, Maine's another, but Vermont and Oregon, some of those are the greatest places. And Detroit, being a Midwest boy, growing up in the Midwest, I really feel that. There's a lot of things that need to shift in America. I feel like if you bring Detroit back, you know, it's our Brooklyn. If you can bring back Detroit from what it went through, we can change a lot of America. I think a lot of it happens in community, the small mom-and-pop shops, that supporting each other instead of the money men, you know, the big system. So, yeah, I'm more about handmade, quality, and community. So, I'd love to tell you the ideas. But they're just ideas right now, so I'm really proof in the pudding. It'll take some time, but I bought it with the intention to do quite a few things in Detroit. So, very cool.
I was a real big fan of The Red Room, and I was really disappointed that you didn't get a third season. So are you going to revisit Philip Coppice, or is that just something on hold?
It's a bummer. Philip's dead.
It's one of those things where there was a changing of the guard
with AMC and Sundance, and they kind of discovered a lot of their shows, and new people moved in, and you know, they're just one of those bastard children. Kind of get pushed aside, unfortunately. I thought it was an amazing show, I really loved it, but it would have been nice to do one more.
But now, we're
doing another thing, and I'm really excited about it, so. We got a shiny show coming out on Netflix, you guys will see. It's about the fur trade in the 1790s and 1800s. And I'm sure you can imagine what I do. It's University English. It's going to be fun.
Very nice. Netflix is the place to be right now, too.
They're kind of taking over the world. So
that's great. Like,
all right, well, jump on that bit.
Right here.
Hi, Jason. I flew down from Philadelphia because I love you.
Yeah,
and I wanted to ask, could you talk about Reason?
Yeah, I wanted to make a very contemporary, contained action film. So it's set in logging community up north, and it's about a family going through some troubles, especially with the father, who has like, he's suffering from severe trauma, brain trauma. It's almost like having dementia or Alzheimer's. And it's a man, he's a total man's man, and he's trying to take care of his family, but he's running the logging company now, and he doesn't know what to do with his father. So it's a really good family story, but it's kind of like this
like a deer hunter meets like Die Hard, essentially a titanic action film. And I don't want to give away too much, but they go up to this cabin, the family cabin, a lot of things happen. Obviously, it's we wanted to pit the put the hunter versus the killer. Makes him literally with like a, you know, a trained killer or someone who's just uses his surroundings and you know, much like Commando. So I wanted to make a really great action film that I wanted to make. And I get a lot of them and they just don't have the acting and the drama side to it. Heartfelt moments with family. And I wanted to do that with my friends right around the snow. And had to fuck some shit up. And release it after Batman Superman, you know what I mean? And release it, you know, after Justice League, something like that. So
very cool.
We're trying to make it happen. It's just there's a lot on the docket. So
right up here.
Hey man, welcome to Dallas, man. I also have one question for you. I was wondering, what house would you rather see on the Iron Throne?
See on the what?
What family would you want to see on the Iron Throne?
Oh, come on, man. What do you think? My wife and the three dragons. She got the imp, talk to the tiger, and the imp and all his horns. By herself. Three dragons. Imp. Three dragons.
Right here.
Comedy, I know you like comedy. Do you plan on making any comedy movies soon? Melissa McCarthy, maybe?
I can't wait to do comedy. I love it. Someday someone will give me a shot. But I just did I did do something with Bruce Willis. And I'll play a cholo.
Are you broke? Cholo is same, man.
We do, it's pretty fun. And some great moments in there, but it's a little character piece, and I enjoy doing that this summer. It doesn't have a name yet, but it's the entitled Bruce Willis Project.
Awesome. Let's go right back over here.
Yeah. From the set of Stargate Atlantis or Game of Thrones, were there anything that you took with you, any souvenirs that made their way to your house?
Oh yeah, I'm a natural born thief. I took everything. The hair, the gun, knives, swords, other people's things. I'm a thief. They actually put like a page on the, just for me, but it's like the whole crew to watch over each other, not take things. And it was on the front of the call sheet, and he's like, I took that shit long ago, man. Silly. Silly Canadians.
Right here.
So we all know how much you love music. It follows you everywhere. So what are some of your musical inspirations?
Tom Waits, Howlin' Wolf, Son House. I love the blues. Funny enough, Ani DiFranco, if anyone knows who that is. It's pretty funny. When I was growing up in high school in Iowa, I'd be at an Ani DiFranco concert, and generally they're all either women who are angry at men, enjoy wearing fatigues, shaking their head. So I think they're great. So I'm partying with them, and it's like singing the song, like it's all like hating on men. I'm like, yeah. I just mean hating on men too. Yeah, my men. And but I just love Ani DiFranco. So yeah. Right now, this is I never was aside from like Patsy Cline and Johnny Cash is this artist, Sturgill Simpson. If I could ever give you anything, it would be to listen to Sturgill Simpson and Sheldon Monroe. And it would be really special and dear to my heart. So I'm really digging those. If you have time, I'll listen to it. I figure you're from Texas. I'm making the assumption that you like country. If you don't, I mean, I love everything. Conan, I just listen to Pantera and Metallica. Like, alright, you listen to, you know, Walk. Walk is probably Pantera. That's probably like the pinnacle of Conan. Like, every morning, it was just like, dun, dun, dun. My wife wasn't there, it's cold, I'm in a skirt. And I would just, like, bleeding all the time. And I would just put naked, is there a lot of kids in here?
No.
I would put pictures of beautiful women. And the birthday suits all over the walls. Happy birthday. And I would be just friggin' frustrated. So that's coming. He's just sexually frustrated. That's the kind of anger I was displaying.
Alright, what do we got?
But for Aquaman, someone asked me, like, what would be Aquaman's song? And for those who like Tool, I'm a big Tool fan. Ticks and Leeches. If you listen to that song, I'll give you a good idea what's coming up.
Nice. Right. So, since we're in Texas, I thought I'd bring up an upcoming project you have, The Bad Batch. I was wondering, your character that you're playing in that, it's a dark comedy and you're a cannibal. Where are you drawing your inspiration from, and what's it like to play a character like that?
That is kind of one of the most amazing things I've ever worked on. Liliana Poir is probably one of my favorite directors. She plucked me out, picked me in, and she was very smitten on getting me to play the role. I don't want to say too much, but it's a effed up fairy tale. What it is, and it's just a really beautiful story, and it fits pretty far out. But I definitely am extremely proud of it. And excited for everyone to see it. It's definitely an art house to open. It's not for everyone.
Well, we've got to wrap things up, but I did want to ask you one last question. In your experience, you've done some awesome roles, and I know you've got a lot of cool stuff coming up. What for you personally has been the most rewarding aspect of what you've done? Is there one thing that you kind of take away from it and think, wow, I just never thought I'd get to do that?
Baywatch.
That was not set up, by the way. That was not set up in any way, I swear.
Why don't you stand up and say that, boy? I'm gonna see you in a little bit. Here's the thing about Baywatch, I was never on it, because I don't remember it. By my memories, I don't remember anything. I can't believe I did that. I mean, I can't believe I'm married, Lisa Bonet. I'll start with that one. Boom. Yeah. Not Baywatch, asshole.